at a bar in a remarkable conversation. The gender, of course, not important, we're libertarians. I shamelessly listened in when one of the persons said, "I will do nothing, I will do anything, anywhere, anytime, in the office, in the bar, in the car, inside and outside this door, you tell me when." On taking the full impact of this provocation, the other individual answered, "We're two of kind," and then stopped to gauge the impact of these words on the other person, only to add, "I also work in government. Are you state or local?" The basic proposition in this paper is that the state and its allied institutions are a clear and present danger to human beings when allowed to run unchecked. Second proposition, this danger becomes an absolute reality, which is when the polity excludes any group from exercising the powers that can redirect or curtail the powers of the new Lord God, the state. In the case of Puerto Rico, it corrupted American liberal democracy through the rule of God, which is the rule of law. I hope to demonstrate that rule by exception Puerto Rico, the relationship imposed by the U.S. on the island, at times the U.S., the most vital and vibrant democracy, enabled, led, enticed, and perhaps forced Puerto Rico into the current financial and economic disaster. Enabled, led, enticed, and forced. Secondly, that the state, government, and political system and parties have robbed the islanders of initiative and liberty through subsidies, transfers of money since the Roosevelt's New Deal, and particularly since the Johnson administration. I would like to suggest that island leaders, in cahoots with the federal government, used entitlements to keep the natives quiet. So financial interests, which are basically those that fund Congress, could launder the taxpayers' money, U.S. taxpayers' money, through Puerto Rican government, through the people in Puerto Rico, and give it to the financial interests. Am I complaining? No. This is the American way. But it's also the way in most of the countries of the world. Giorgio Agamben built the history of the transformation of the state into God to explain the thesis that the exception to the rule of law and the political way of government are an integral part of liberal democracy. Before Agamben, Carl Schmitt wrote in Political Theology. Agamben picked up his train of thought, and then some other American philosophers or theorists have jumped into this train of thought. Bruce Ackerman amongst them. It seems that the state of emergency and corollary, the state of exception, are part of the America's way of life. It is also part of the way of life of most liberal democracies in the world. We are not as exceptional as we think Americans are. Schmitt supported the extermination of Jews, Roma, homosexuals, and disabled in Nazi Germany. This does not mean that the U.S. will do that. By no means. Only it means that our democracy and fascism have a common ancestor. But then, we also have a common ancestor with the gorillas and the chimpanzees. Nothing wrong with that. State of emergency generally tied with a war, but Governor Fortuño, whom you will hear tomorrow or day past tomorrow, declared an emergency in learning the condition of the state finances in 2009. What is then the state of emergency? It is a temporary suspension of the rule of law and of some of the rights of institutions and of human beings. Again, let me note, this is the submission of liberty, is the price that we pay for government. Government, most of the time, takes away some of our liberties, and we yield them. As long as we get something in return, that's possible. In a permanent state of emergency, you can have a special rule of law. And that special rule of law doesn't mean that we're lawless. We'll set aside a group of people. This is what the Nazi did. But then, would you believe that this was done when Puerto Ricans became part of the states? And for good reason. There were 70 million Americans in the states. There were 7 to 10 million Filipinos, Puerto Ricans, and Guamanians, or Chamorros. Most of those were in the Philippine Islands, 1 million Puerto Rico. But in 1900, 4 years after Plessy versus Ferguson, established that it was okay to separate people by race. Remember, the U.S. decided then to separate Puerto Ricans. Why? Most Filipinos were Malays. Most Filipinos did not speak Spanish or English. Most Filipinos were of different shades of color. And then the leadership thought, and hear me, hear this. This is the research done by two judges of the U.S. Supreme Court, Judge Cabranes and Judge Torreira. We have to set them aside. If those 10 million ever become a state, they will have the most power of any state in the nation. That scared the wits out of Congress, out of the U.S. Supreme Court, out of every single leader in the nation. The nation's changed, hasn't it? Changed a lot. The law is still the same. We're still ruled by the same law. The leaders changed. Am I saying that Mr. Trump is a racist? Don't answer that. No. Am I saying that Mr. Obama was a racist? Don't answer that, please. No. I am saying that there's a structure which is very difficult to change. And why? That structure is the exception. And that structure is what allows most investors that come into Puerto Rico not to pay taxes. I've got nothing against that. I've got nothing for taxes, okay? But listen to the trend of thought of Puerto Ricans. Would you believe that 10 years ago, 11, there was a gigantic march all over Atorrey, the banking area, for people asking, please raise taxes? Would you believe that? Gigantic. It was led by the unions, government unions, because they were fighting the possibility of layoffs because the government didn't have the money to pay them. This is the only country where you've had a movement led by people, by the people, for the people, and with the people to raise taxes. Are we dumb? No. We were schooled in the exception that we had to be different from the rest of the states. And most of us think that we have to be different from the rest of the states if we want to remain Puerto Ricans. We will be absorbed into this gigantic monster. Wow! How many people here do I see absorbed by this gigantic monster? Is it bad? Is it good? Well, believe me, if my grandfather were to see me today, he would not recognize me. I'm totally different from what my grandfather was, and we're not yet absorbed. Come on, I'm a cultural anthropologist. We're already there. We just won't speak English, that's all. Now, is the exception something unique? Nope. The exception is very much a part of this nation. How many of you who are from the States remember when you were taught in high school that Judge Marshall decided that the final arbiter of all laws in the nation was the Supreme Court? That was part of the high school textbook. Where in the Constitution does it say that? Nowhere. Who invented it? Marshall. Why was it accepted by the House and the Senate and by the President? Marshall was brilliant. He made sure that the Federalists received the person that they had appointed by judging against an appointment. So both parties were happy and they accepted Marshall's judgment. That's an exception. Another exception. Before that, any of you remember, mention the Northwest Ordinances? President Madison, who was basically the author of the Constitution, said that the United States had no power to take over the land of the Indian nations immediately to the west of the original states. And what did we do? Northwest Ordinance, we're gonna take it away. And we took it. That was an exception. Why? The politicians agreed. 1804, Jefferson had said, I have no power to buy Louisiana. What did Jefferson do? He doubled the size of the nation by buying Louisiana. Everyone agreed. So we've got a constitution. It says one thing, but the politicians say something else. Is this unconstitutional? No. It's extra constitutional. And it becomes the law of the land. You also heard, so those of you from the States, the backing of the court by President Roosevelt. He wanted to increase the number of judges. So he would have his judges passing. He couldn't get it through, but that was an attempt at an exception. But he did in 1942 capture a number of Nazis in a submarine and subjected them to martial law. But then here comes this young George Bush and says, I'm going to do the same case with Boumediene. And the court said, we're not at war. You cannot do it. Another attempt at that exception. So you've got two ways that we have developed. Developing exceptions, and at the same time, there has been, when there's no political support, we can't get the exception through. That happened to George, and that happened to Roosevelt, who, by the way, won the next election. Brilliantly. So the people supported the president, but the politicians didn't. Why do I want to go through all of this? Puerto Rico is an exception. We're still an exception. For what reason? It is clearly not racial anymore. It is clearly not that we speak Spanish anymore. It is clearly that we are not gender. We belong to all different genders. What are the other reasons for that do not allow you to discriminate? None of them are applicable anyway. Why are we an exception? Why have we not been thrown out into the world with independence or brought into the nation? The interests are too great. Someone's making a hell of a lot of money off Puerto Rico. And you believe I agree? Am I not a capitalist? Of course I agree. But the first thing you have to do is accept it. If you don't like it, accept that it exists and then go the other way. You know, we were so artful in all of this that one day we started calling us the best of both worlds. Why? We got all kinds of money transfers from the states and we paid no personal income tax and very few corporate taxes. Any here from any of the states, would you like to have that? No income tax? I can't blame you. Best of both worlds, but what did we give up in turn? The right to have people sitting in Congress and the right to elect a president who make the decisions of whether we can keep this or not. And one day, Congress woke up, 1996, and eliminated one of those exceptions, 936. Did they ask us? No. We had a faction here, statehood, who said, yes, we want you to eliminate it. We have another faction, equally strong, that wanted to keep it. But we had not a single vote in Congress. We couldn't wheel and deal. And one of the basic things that Madison told us is, men are not angels. They are subject to all of the passions and all of the viciousness. And if it were not for some who have moral compunctions, we would kill anyone that's not from our tribe. You know why? We get scared. I meet someone different, wow. That scares me. I go into a community which I don't know, that scares me. It's natural to be scared. In fact, if we didn't get scared when we went out of the tribe, when we went out of the cave, and we decided that we would go in twos and threes and four when we're gonna go hunting, the wild animals would have picked us up one by one, and there would be no human race. Fear is the primal feeling of man, and the one thing that has allowed man to continue. So we have to live with fear and we have to accept fear. And Puerto Rican's fear change. Wow. We don't want to become a state. We don't want to become a republic. We want to stay as we are. Oh, but you don't have anyone in Congress? No. And we don't want our own president. In fact, statehood advocates will tell Puerto Ricans, oh boy, if we get the mayor of San Juan as governor, as president, she's a Maduro advocate. So this is what awaits us if we go into the independence. What was I talking about? Fear. Oh, we will lose an American citizen. Well, this is very practical. When the going gets tough in Puerto Rico, Puerto Ricans get going. Florida, we lost 400,000 in 10 years. The projection for the next 5 years is 200,000. Who's leaving? The young, those who are in productive age, and who's staying? Yours truly. I can't sell my house. My mortgage is bigger than the market price. And this has happened to most of Puerto Rican middle class. Fear. We can't afford change. Well, I'll tell you what. My kids left Puerto Rico. I can't say that they have the stature of Leonardo, who stayed to fight it out in Venezuela. My kids left Puerto Rico. They couldn't find a job in Puerto Rico. Why don't I live in Puerto Rico? Where am I going to go? Live with my kids? I wouldn't wish that on anyone. Now, why do I say the exception applies to Puerto Rico? Triple tax exemption. The only jurisdiction in the nation that has triple tax exemption. Florida bondholders do not pay state taxes in Florida. So they have triple tax exemption as long as they live in Florida. Anyone that buys a Puerto Rican bond is triple tax exempt, even if they live in Hawaii. Who passed that law? Not Puerto Rico, the U.S. Congress. These are the types of laws which are possible in the exception. And they seem to be good, and I do tell you that you have to examine them. I'm not asking you to go by the way I think. But you've got to look into this. And I'm going to conclude with something a hedge fund manager wrote in 2016. I'm going to give you his name. Please don't laugh. Anthony Scaramucci. And you know what he wrote? I'm going to read what he wrote. But I chose Scaramucci because he is less biased than Heritage, that says exactly the same thing that he does. And he's easier to understand than the IMF person that came here and did a study of Puerto Rico. So, bear with me. Puerto Rico's downward spiral conceivably began in 2006 when U.S. government phased out tax credits, remember? U.S. government phased out tax credits. Do we have a representation in U.S. government? Right now we have a very nice lady who sits there. Before we had a very nice gentleman with no vote. We have noted that 936 was possible only because it was an exception. The treatment of American citizens in Puerto Rico as different or special in the sense of not being able to develop fully without help from the U.S. Where are we not? I'm here to help you. I'm from government. Immediately afterwards, Scaramucci says, but the crisis has really been brewing for decades because of triple tax exempt status of Puerto Rican bonds, meaning bondholders don't have to pay local, state, or federal taxes on income derived from these bonds. The only other triple tax exemption occurs if an investor buys bonds in the state in which he or she lives. Again, condition possible only because we were set aside initially because we were black, we spoke Spanish, we were Catholics. Now that's gone. But the exception is still there. Someone's interested in maintaining this exception. The triple tax exemption made Puerto Rico bonds attractive to American mutual funds, causing institutions to gorge themselves on the island's debt. In turn, the massive amounts of capital raised by the Puerto Rican government
was squandered in ways that didn't bring economic growth necessary to sustain a massive debt problem. Too much money. What else made them desirable? General obligation bonds are guaranteed by the Constitution of Puerto Rico. Who approved the Constitution of Puerto Rico? Puerto Ricans, but it had to be approved afterwards by whom? The U.S. Congress. In fact, some things the U.S. Congress didn't like, they told Puerto Ricans, eliminate them. He continues, for almost 2 years, rating agencies and Puerto Rico's governors have been warning this day would come, when Puerto Rico would be unable to pay its debts and urging Congress to come up with a restructuring plan. At the same time, Puerto Rico's misfortunes caused its own bonds to trade at discount to par, attracting hedge funds specializing in distressed debt. I would have bought them too. These hedge funds counted on the extensive legal protection afforded to the Puerto Rican bondholders, especially for those owning geo bonds. Is there another exception here? Yes. This wouldn't work otherwise. Puerto Rico is not a sovereign country, so that it has fewer tools for escaping economic hell than a sovereign nation like Argentina. Sovereigns have the ability to hit reset button by devaluating their currencies, and thus the real value of their debts, as well as appeal to the IMF. Puerto Rico has no such options. We can only appeal to Congress, who says, you already got too much money. Oh, but you did it for Mexico. Well, Mexico is another thing. Mexico in 1990. Well, Mexico is foreign. You are foreign, an exception. We are foreign in a domestic way. That is the definition of Puerto Rico, foreign in a domestic way, made up by the U.S. Supreme Court. Exception. Puerto Rico, with a population of 3.5 million, has a total of $72 billion in debt spread across 17 government agencies. Only New York, with a robust economy and a population of around 20 million, and California, with nearly 40 million residents, are more indebted than Puerto Rico's debt to GNP ratio. Only two states, and fabulously wealthy. This is a structural feature of what? The exception. Am I complaining? No. I'm stating a fact. This is the nature of America. Love it or leave it. Okay? We have been quite happy to live in this context and tradition for more than 100 years. The law of the land is the rule of law for the nation, and another rule of law for whom? Puerto Ricans. Philippines got away, they became independent. This is heavy indeed, but the island pension system is in a similar disarray. The island's pension obligations are largely an afterthought, as the government tries to keep the lights on, but they are in the most dire straits of all. Puerto Rican pension funds have less than 1% of the assets needed to pay all promised benefits. We went on a spending spree, and we didn't know how to stop. Our governors, totally irresponsible. Will they go to jail? No. Were they crazy? You may say that they were crazy. Will they go into an asylum? No. I will conclude my comments with Scaramucci's on his characterization of Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico is like a migrant worker in Dubai, hired reluctantly into a suspect arrangement, passport taken away, drowned with debt, and held hostage to repay with money it doesn't have. This is an apt description of the state of exception. Thank you so very much, and I just finished in time, not in full.